everyone. Good morning. Welcome. Our 129th annual meeting and education conference is now in full swing. We hope you are following us on our social media and using the app. In just a few minutes, you'll need that app for some audience participation. We hope you utilize that. So please take a moment to download that app or show me what they're upset. Once again, we want to thank our wonderful sponsors for their support of this meeting. Our top sponsors are Landiscure, NRDCA, ITRON, API. Let's give them a round of applause, please. For this morning's general session, examining a recent and very sobering issue for everyone in the country, this year, unfortunately, witnessed a spate of hurricanes that unleashed record-breaking devastation. The Honorable Ron Brzee, my dear friend from Florida, will help us unpack this issue. First, we are joined by Granger Morgan, who will discuss how we can enhance the resilience of the nation's electricity system. Mr. Morgan is a Hamish Live University professor of engineering at Carnegie Mellon University. He holds appointments in three academic units, Department of Energy, Public Policy, the Department of Computer Engineering, and the H. John Hines College. He currently chairs the Committee on Enhancing Resilience of the Nation's Electric Power and Transmission System. Please welcome Mr. Granger Morgan.
Clear at the outset, most disruptions, of course, are caused by things like squirrels getting in the wrong place and getting themselves electrocuted, lightning strikes, drivers hitting utility poles. That's not the subject of this report. This report is about wide area outages that go on for a long time, 3 days or more. And these are more common than you might initially think. We plotted here on a log plot the occurrence of outages, and you can see that this distribution is a fat tail. And there are other things that we've never experienced, like solar mass ejection, solar storms, that could push even further out. And as Puerto Rico reminds us, large, long-duration outages are not just possible, they happen. And this is the sad restoration plot for Puerto Rico. They recently lost a transmission line that had come on. Now there's a difference between resilience and reliability. Reliability is what everybody in the business worries about. It's keeping the lights on. Resilience is more than that. This Random House Dictionary definition says the power or the ability to return to the original form position after being bent, compressed, or stretched. In other words, it's about figuring out how, in the event of a large outage, to get things put back together. And we obviously need to do everything we can to minimize the possibility of large outages, but at the same time, we have to acknowledge that they may occur, and sooner or later, in many cases, probably will. So we organized our report around this framework, starting out with some incident or event, and then thinking about the kinds of things you have to do ahead of time to be ready if that event occurs. And then sorts of things you could be doing during the event to minimize consequences. Of course, you can only do those things if you thought about them and prepared, in many cases, ahead of time, and then putting the system back together afterwards. And so here's the organization of the report, which, as I say, follows that diagram. Chapter one basically frames the issue, points out that electricity is critical to more or less everything we do today in modern society. It then goes on to observe that despite all the talk about off-grid and distributed resources and so on, for at least the next several decades, most consumers are going to be dependent on a large, centrally organized grid. And while we should do everything we can to minimize the possibility of large outages, they are going to occur, and we ought to try to be in better shape to deal with them. Now, chapter two, the first part actually of this chapter, most of you know. Sue Tierney, who many of you know, was the lead author on this chapter. But she did a lovely tutorial on the current state of the power system and the incredibly complex and heterogeneous nature of the system. And if you ever have people, for example, who you're trying to get up to speed, new staff or something, the first half of that chapter, I think, is a very nice tutorial. The latter part is about how the grid may evolve over the coming decades. We did not lay out a single or a couple of scenarios. Instead, we said, here are all the possible things that could happen that could shape the way the grid evolves. The one thing I want to say a word about is metrics. Now, you all know about metrics for reliability. And the way they work is they look back at events that have occurred and they compute statistics. And the problem, of course, with resilience is that, thank God, most of the things we're worried about haven't actually happened. So trying to compute statistics is not a particularly viable strategy. So the report calls for a coordinated assessment of the numerous resilience metrics that have been proposed and for studies also of how customers value power in long outages. Many utilities, of course, have done studies of how customers value short outages, and Berkeley National Labs has produced a compendium of all of that, but there's been very little work on longer outages. So we wrap up Chapter 2 with five summary observations. The grid's undergoing dramatic change, but at the same time, the hardware that makes up the grid is very long-lived, and that limits the speed with which change can occur. No single entity is in charge of planning the evolution of the grid, and all players are concerned about reliability, but only a few focused in a serious way on identifying growing system-wide vulnerabilities, and virtually nobody has a primary mission of building and sustaining increased system-wide resilience. This is the basic problem in this space. There's nobody in charge. So let me start with Chapter 3, which lays out a bunch of the sorts of things that could cause large outages. I'm not going to talk about them all. Here's a little diagram that says, you know, some of them could result from human activities, terrorists, cyber hackers, and maybe even, you know, operator errors in control rooms, and then a whole slew of natural events. And this collage that I've put together is just basically help you think about it, what a few of them look like. So on the upper left corner are first a report that the old Office of Technology Assessment in the U.S. Congress did about 30 years ago on physical attacks on the power system. And then the one, terrorism with electric power delivery system, is one I shared some years ago. We, in our report on terrorism, were very careful not to say, you know, five guys in the back of station wagons with rifles and armor piercing bullets could do a real job. The OTA was far less guarded in its remarks. And we're still physically very vulnerable. Of course, we're also vulnerable to cyber issues. The lower left corner shows you what a good earthquake can do to major facilities and substations. The diagram in the middle of each, or the picture in the middle of PJM's control room is just to remind us that operator error can sometimes be a problem, but it rarely could. It's hard to see how it could lead to very long duration outages. And the two images in the upper right corner are related to solar mass ejections. Now, we've not had a big solar storm, a really big solar storm, since the middle of the 19th century. And we didn't have a continent-spanning power system back then. But But if and when we do get one, and sooner or later we almost certainly will get one that hits the Earth, it could be extremely disruptive. Okay, so now let me talk about verse chapter 4, which is getting ready ahead of time. And there are a whole variety of things one can do. Since this report is available online and there's not a whole lot of time here, I'm not going to read through all of this. You can actually probably read faster than I can talk anyway. But I am going to say another word or two about this final one. Cybersecurity is about keeping the bad guys out. And this industry, of course, has been spending a lot of time thinking about issues of cybersecurity and how I keep folks out. But cyber resilience is about continuing to perform the mission even when the bad guys have gotten in. And they may have been in for a long time, sitting there, sort of looking around, snooping, and figuring out what they could do. And one needs to, on one hand, be vigilant to try to figure out that they're there, but then on the other hand, also figure out how do you keep the system running once it's become infected and there are significant ongoing problems. I tried actually in this report to introduce the term cyber black star as compared with physical black star. My committee wouldn't let me use that phrase, but it basically indicates the sort of problem that I'm talking about. How do you get things cleaned up and running well enough, limping along while you're infected? Here are recommendations from chapter 4, and again, you can, since this report is online, and these are very brief summaries, you can go online and download the whole report and get some detailed sense of the sorts of things we're suggesting. Let me talk just a bit more, though, about the ideas in chapter 5. This is probably the part of the problem that our society has spent the least time working on. That is on how to make sure that if and when one of these very large, long-duration outages occurs, we are in pretty good shape to at least deal with critical social services to provide limited electricity-dependent services to others. Experience shows, of course, that when one of these outages occurs, people like hospitals or others who think they've got backup sometimes discover that the backup doesn't work. And so the first insight, of course, is that one needs to test these things on a continuous basis. And you may think you've got a secure fuel supply, but if this is a large outage across quite a wide region, the fuel delivery may be a problem. Others, you know, maybe the vice president might move in and commandeer fuel trucks or something. And so there are basic issues there in terms of existing backup. We need more work, too, on advanced preparations for use of non-traditional sources. So I've shown here a Canadian National diesel locomotive that got pressed into service during the ice storm in Quebec. You can only do that, of course, if you've got the box that you need to convert the output from the diesel into 60 hertz AC power. Same is true of ships. The Navy doesn't like to talk about it, but we have on occasion used ships in port. And you know, large cruise ships are big mobile generators. But again, using these things requires a bit of early preparation. A lot of people, in growing numbers, have rooftop TV. And as most of this room knows, but most general customers don't know, when the power goes out, you can't get power off that PV rooftop, even though I may have a battery associated with it. The reason is a perfectly reasonable one. It's that you don't want back feed out to endanger line them. But technically, there's no reason, when the distribution system is not energized, why people with rooftop PV and batteries couldn't get low amperage service. And the safety and other issues could be adequately dealt with technically and with appropriate regulatory interventions. I've also shown an electric vehicle here. We're going to have more and more hybrid and fuel cell vehicles parked in our driveways. And if at the moment I took power off my electric vehicle, I would violate the warranty. But you can imagine situations where you would want people to be able to get a bit of power from their vehicles parked in their driveway in order to, for example, in the dead of winter, keep the blower or the pumps working on the, on their furnace. Now, there hadn't been, as I said, studies of the value of long duration, that customers supply long duration outages. At Carnegie Mellon, I have a doctor student right now who's working in that area. We've all seen these diagrams in the lower left of these smart grid pictures. Most of that's still vapor. I mean, you know, we've got smart meters, we've got a few other things, but if we push things further along so that, for example, with ease, I could cut back the demands for customers on a feeder, turn it into an isolated feeder, which I power with some distributed resources that I've got on that feeder, I could substantially reduce the vulnerability, the social vulnerabilities. And the diagram in the lower right is just to raise one other issue of this sort. This is a picture from chapter two. The top picture shows a five-story building with a little gas-fired generator. And of course, under federal law, the local utility must interconnect. But take those five floors and I plop them down across the countryside. Because of exclusive service purpose, exclusive service territory rules, that's not legal. And there might be a case to be made for figuring out ways to encourage more of that sort of stuff that is privately operated, small microgrids down under the distribution system, which could, under some circumstances, provide a great deal of resilience. The last chapter I want to talk about is chapter six, which is about putting things back together. And this is actually a diagram that shows how this is a fractal issue. That is, you got to work it at the site, at the system, at the regional level. And you got to take a variety of steps. Now, plan and preparation are not the same thing. Plan is the sort of stuff you've done beforehand. Preparation, on the other hand, is the stuff that you're doing to make sure you got the trucks lined up, that you've got the resources in place. That's the logistical stuff. And then you got to manage and do a restore and recover. Again, here are the summary of the recommendations of Chapter 6. And again, I'm not going to read them because you can read faster than I can speak. And furthermore, as I said, you can download this report and read the details that underlie each of them. I might just say, however, that one of the things that we really think is important is that research at the Department of Energy continue. I'll come back to that in just a moment. So, in putting this report together, we produced 12 sets of specific recommendations. I'm not going to talk about them. They're directed at particular players across the industry. And there are a couple of recommendations that are specific to state officers, regulators, and to NERUC. And there are things like making sure that testing and role play, tabletop events, that sort of thing, continue to get done. There are issues of supporting the development of capability to do islanding when an outage occurs, if you've got resources on an intact distribution system, facilitating the greater use of distributed energy resources and microgrids as a protection against, or in order to be able to provide some modest power during outages. And then also to NERUC, a couple of suggestions that NERUC develop broad guidance for commissioners, because commissioners have got their hands full dealing with day-to-day sorts of things. If they got a bit of guidance on how to think about and address some of these issues, that might be useful. Now, we ended this report, and actually began it as well, with a set of seven overarching recommendations. And we did this because, as I said a couple of times, nobody's in charge, and nobody is going to be in charge. And so the collective problem is to raise awareness across the whole community. So, recommendation one is to continue and expand conduct of exercises that simulate accidental failures and figure out who has to talk to who and how it works. We're already doing a lot of that, but it's really important that we should continue and expand. The second one is to get capabilities that already exist out and into the system. And in many cases, of course, these can be justified for reasons other than just resilience. But we've often been a little slow about getting some of it into place. This third report, or third recommendation, is about research, and in particular about the important role that the Office of Electricity at the Department of Energy is playing. As some of you know, there were some early proposals in this administration to simply completely defund research at the DOE through the Office of Electricity. The committee doesn't say how the DOE should do this work, but it does say that continuing this work is really important. For example, you all know about the problem of replacement transformers and the fact that these things are big and hard to move. DOE is supporting research on solid-state power electronics to produce transformers which would be more compact, and it could be electrically tuned so that when you plug them in, you can tune them to the particular electrical characteristics needed for that particular replacement. That sort of thing is important and ought to continue. The next two are, first, to continue to do things on the physical side, and second, to do things on the cyber side to improve resilience. And then these last ones are basically about trying to raise awareness across the whole community. So we're arguing that DOE and DHS should jointly go through the exercise of trying to understand just how serious the situation would be if we had various kinds of large, long-duration outages. Then we recommend that FERC and the North American Electric Reliability Corporation should take those and look at them from the system transmission level, that NARUC and others should look at them at the more local and regional level, and then each state public utility commission, state energy offices, and others should all try to understand what's the implication. What would happen if we lost power, say, in the middle of the winter in upstate New York for many, many weeks? That particular event, of course, has happened, but lots of other events like that haven't happened. We need to be thinking much more about how to get ready to deal with such things. They're very low probability, but if and when they happen, they have high consequences. The answer of what we're going to do depends, of course, very much on where we are, what part of the country we're talking about, and the particular local circumstances. So with that, I'll say thank you. Again, I appreciate the opportunity to talk to this audience, and as I said, you can download this report and be happy to, if there may be time for a question or two right now, but I would be happy to deal with any other questions through email follow-up if you would like.
There is always this issue of the cost of resilience. During your study, were you able to at least provide some guidelines what would be appropriate investment? Of course, if it happens to you, there's not enough money to pay, but some guidelines on that.
Yeah, well, that's a tough one. And the simple answer is we did not adequately address it, but we did talk about it. First of all, as I said a minute ago, there are a few things you could do that you probably want to do anyway because they provide other benefits. And so those are reasonably straightforward. There's some things that provide collective social benefit that you maybe don't even want to pay for through conventional rate-based schemes. And so we don't talk about in any detail how to figure out, but one could imagine particular communities that are very very vulnerable that decide, well, we can do these sorts of things through rate-based recovery, but then there are a couple of things we ought to be doing simply because they provide both the social benefits and also address issues of equity that maybe we want to address with tax-based or other strategies. Equity issues are really important in this space. I mean, my son, for example, lives in the suburbs of Manchester, New Hampshire, in a nice modern or new community. And when they had an outage as a result of a storm a few weeks ago, you know, much of Manchester from the suburbs were out of power, but every house in this neighborhood, you could go by and the lights were on and the heat was running and so on because these new houses all had pad-mounted gas generators. So that's an illustration of the sort of equity issues. I mean, if I do things only on the basis of customer willingness to pay, you could imagine situations where very serious equity concerns arise. We've probably got time for one more, according to the time we're here. And seeing none, maybe I will. Oh. Yeah. So I will say thank you very much. Really appreciate this opportunity.
Thank you, Professor Morgan. You gotta go up that way. All right. So we want to thank Professor Morgan for his insights on resilience of our grid. In my opinion, my humble opinion, being from Florida, we've seen our fair share of wind disasters. And in terms of my personal experience, I think I've seen more firsthand than I want to see for the rest of my life. So, but I know the rest of you may face either wind, fire, snow, water, earthquakes, and a variety of natural disasters. And these are things that we have to deal with as commissioners and people within this space. And you know, I'm going back to a couple of things that caused me to get into the work that I do now and policy work that I did before in the legislature was just how we deal with the aftermath, how to prepare for and engage with these challenges as we deal with natural disasters. So in 2004, 2005, we had 8 hurricanes impact the state of Florida. These storms caused in excess of $2 billion of impact because of the totality of these storms in back-to-back years exhausted our utility storm reserves. This resulted in a significant impact in ratepayer bills to cover restoration. As a result of these hurricanes, and their resulting economic impact. In January 2006, our commission established a process which included a workshop to explore lessons learned. These workshops included a series of orders and rules implementing storm hardening and preparation activities. The goal was simply to upgrade the system to mitigate storm impacts during a storm and restoration efforts afterwards. This involved a delicate balance between the need for robust transmission and distribution system and the rate impact on our utility customers. These steps included an 8-year wooden pole inspection program for both electric and telephone companies, an annual hurricane preparedness briefing every June, annual distribution reliability reports that allow the commission to gauge outage frequency and duration, a 3-year trim cycle, new rules to promote undergrounding, and other initiatives. Prior to a storm, our emergency operations center is activated and the commission obtains a presence at the EOC 24 hours function as a liaison with utility representatives. As an example for Irma, our EOC presence began on September 6th and continued to September 22nd. Our staff put in almost 600 man hours during that period of time. Speaking of Irma, 6.7 million customers, approximately 64% of the state, lost power. All 67 counties in our state lost power. 10 counties experienced more than 90% customer outage. Thankfully, due to mutual aid agreements and the great work of our utilities, we had restoration efforts moving quickly. Talking about mutual aid, about 60,000 people from across the country came in and provided support to our utilities. So as we prepare for the next portion of our session, I want to remind you to take out your phone, right? This is not something we typically do, but we want you to take out your phone, visit your app provider for your smartphone, and download the NARUG 2017 app. There's only one app in the world that says NARUG, so there's no confusion there. So it should be easy to find. So take the time right now to take out your phone and see if you can identify the app. I'm sure you are probably using the app to figure out where you're supposed to be next. And so at this time, I'd like to invite my panelists to the stage as I call their names, and I'd ask you to hold the applause until all the panelists have been introduced. So first, we have Joy Ditto, and she is the president and CEO of Utilities Technology Council, a Washington-based association representing vital energy and water companies. Then we have Chris Franklin, the CEO and Chief Executive Officer of Aqua Utilities, a publicly traded water and wastewater utility serving 3 million customers across 8 states. Next we have Calvin Butler Jr., CEO of Baltimore Gas and Electric, and thank you to you that we have power here today. Next, please help me welcome Pierce Norton, the president and CEO of One Gas and chair of the American Gas Association's board of directors. For a regulatory perspective, please help me welcome Commissioner Jeremy Oden of Alabama. Lastly, and certainly not least, Stephanie Brand, the director of the New Jersey Division of Rate Council, basically the consumer advocate, which represents the interests of utility customers. So please help me give them a warm welcome. Make sure that you click on the Baltimore event. Go to Tuesday morning and click on the meeting item, Mother Nature, the Great Disruptor. Or you can simply click on the app and then go to the top left corner and click on that, and then you'll see polls, and you can click on that to get to it quicker. So you don't have to answer all the questions at once, but if you can, you can go right ahead and do so. And as we go through the questions, we'll see our responses live in front of us. So, which is the better operating system? And this is a very controversial question, at least in my household, Apple or Android? there. I think we do. And I can't make out what it is. Oh, it's in front of me. Thank you. Wow. So it says Apple is the best operating system. I would tend to personally disagree, but we'll go with that. Now we see that the system works. Let's move on to some more relevant questions. As a consumer, after a major natural disaster, how long is acceptable to be without utilities? Okay, and here's our answers. 22 for 12 hours, 33 for 24 hours, 64 for 3 days, 7 for 5 days, and 24 for 1 week. Now, obviously this is very general with a lot of variables that go into how you may feel about that at the time. But perhaps you may have a situation that really creates an extended outage, which may go well beyond that time, which reflects the reality on the ground. How prepared do you think the average household is for a natural disaster? Okay, and so here we have, 33 say, haven't thought about it much. If we get a state of stability, all right. So here we have, haven't thought about it much. It's on my to-do list. Have a stash of batteries, canned foods, and water prepared for 3 to 5 days without utilities, or the bunker is stocked and ready. And so we see that the option two right now seems to be the one that is the prevailing answer, and that is, it's on my to-do list. And that is probably where most of our consumers are. It's on my to-do list, unless you've had a hurricane or a natural disaster of a similar type a couple weeks before, then people are really engaged and seeking to get prepared. Okay? So for this question, you don't need your phone. In the event, so you need to raise your hands, I think that will be helpful. In the event of a natural disaster, who are the three people you would call? Just think of their names, okay? Does everyone have those names in their mind? Now, without using your phone, what are their phone numbers? Right? All right, for fun, how many of you know the phone numbers for the three people that you thought of? Well, that's actually pretty good. Okay, how about two? Okay, one. And you don't have to raise your hand if you don't recall. So in the event of a natural disaster, you needed to use someone else's phone because you didn't have power to power up your own phone. We recognize the importance of having these things in our memory, or at least written down somewhere, so that we can have access to them. Most of us have become increasingly dependent on electronic devices and electricity, which can be very convenient and efficient. But it isn't until the disaster strikes that we realize that we are less prepared and more vulnerable. We should recognize our vulnerabilities and take steps to mitigate the impact of things like natural disaster. This is a responsibility that we all share as individuals, consumers, as companies, and as a society. Now, let's see how our panelists will respond to a similar question. So you have these little whiteboards, okay? on a scale of from 1 to 5, 1 being not prepared and 5 being very prepared, how prepared do you think your local utilities are for a natural disaster? Now, you don't have to show the response right now. So panelists, please use the small whiteboards as I've indicated already. Write down your answers and keep them for yourself. We will get back to your answers after the break. So this time, we're gonna take a little bit of a break, and we hope to have you back in about 10 to 15 minutes, and then we'll engage with our panelists. Thank you very much. Enjoy your break.